you watch the Tahitian guys, right? You see in together, paddle blades, same angle together, out together, forward.
We'll get a copy of these videos for you guys.
Yeah, I'll send you guys.
I want to ask about when the blade hits the water in the front, the catch. Is it, does your blade, see how Alton is straighter coming in, and then Grant seems to be a little bit more in the back, down, and then hits the water.
Yeah, so what you really want to look at is exactly where it goes in, right? Let's get these guys moving a little bit. The first, I mean, at our level, I feel of paddling, the first thing I look for is speed of top hand. Because that tells me if you're slipping or if the boat's blade is grabbing water. If the top hand is slow, I know there's efficiency. Second thing I look at is where the blade is deep and what angle it is loaded the water on.
Loaded the water on. Got it.
Meaning, this is where he reaches. To me, this is where he's loaded.
Right. Because of the depth of the blade and the angle both.
Now it's in the water.
Okay.
The nice thing about this is he may be reaching way out there like that. There's not a lot of cavitation going on.
Too much twist?
Not for a stroker, for me.
Okay.
Everybody else I teach, not too much rotation to make sure you get the load, make sure you got efficiency, make sure you're in where you can sink the blade. Strokers I allow to get out of their comfort zone to let everybody feel like they have time to reach.
Because they don't have to have a huge power.
Not so much. But they have to have a lot of reach, very good recovery, good time in the water. The recovery has to be smooth and not too quick, or otherwise it feels funny. There's a lot of things, and you know, that rhythm, the reach, how far out that blade is so important for a stroker. Because that tells everybody else how easy it is for them to do what they need to do. A stroker recovers too quick, nobody can keep up. A stroker goes in the water too quick, it'll feel too fast. A stroker comes back too slow, you can't, I mean, there's so many things. It's a very technical seat. The nice thing is you don't have to pull hard up there. That's why I always loved it. Put the paddle in, feel it. Well, it's going good enough. I don't have to work hard, right? It's funny, you know, we used to put this team together. I used to race what's called the Hawaii Canoe Kayak Team. We put all these K-1 guys together, and it was all people who were involved either in Hawaii K-1 Olympic stuff or someone from the mainland who was involved with our team. And we'd sit around a table, Kalakutea and I, who passed away years ago, and we'd say, yeah, we'll take him, let's call him. We'd practice like 2 days in the 6-man, then we'd do Molokai. We'd always be in like the top 2, 3, or 4. Everybody was fit and very efficient, you know, and all this kind of stuff. And I would stroke. We raced Catalina one time, and I was always, I grew up steering. I was like the Corral guy 30 years ago, you know. And that was a long time ago. Anyway. I got in the stroking seat, and I was kind of going hard. And I get out on the motorboat, and everybody's going, oh, I didn't feel that good. And we're like, oh, kind of this and that, right? Next time I got in, I put that paddle in, I just let it come back with the boat speed. And everybody went, oh yeah, perfect, right there. And I thought, I'm not doing anything. You know, you're pulling. It's natural to pull water, you know. But because I had that timing in the water, the boat flew. And when I got into Molokai, every time I got in, I had to tell myself, don't pull hard, or I would wreck it. If I wanted my seat, I did something wrong, right? And I wasn't a guy, you put 2, 3, I'd say, you put me in 1 or you put me in 6 or you don't use me, because I'm useless in the middle of the boat, is how I felt, you know. But I had my things. And then we were second 1 year in Molokai, and I remember had myself, Kalakukea, Bruce Blankenfeld, and you know, all these legends, you know, and I'm up there just kind of toying around, you know, they're shoving me into these waves, and I would get out of the boat, and I'd be like, kind of guilty, I didn't go there. But because when I pulled hard, I screwed it up. The job is not to mess the boat up. You can come in and be a strong guy, pull too hard, pull too fast, or pull too early, you screw the whole boat up if it's a smooth boat, right?
And that's a big steersman mistake too, because we're always catching up and trying to push too hard.
And you should always be perfect timing, you should be a paddler
first.
So, but what I was saying is there's not a lot of cavitation with him. And a real good way to check his cavitation is on the start, right? There's not a lot here. he's got a real good reach. He's not really pulling too early before it's right. in the water.
Right.
You know, on the second stroke, not seeing a lot of water is really good. Who is it?
It's Grant.
Yeah. So he's got feel. He's not trying to overpower the boat, which is nice.
Awesome.
Yeah. What happens that I don't like is the second half of his stroke is fast. And it's because this top hand punches forward at the end. Right? It was here, knuckles are forward. Right here, he goes quick.
Is that too much bend, too, in the elbow? More
a little
further
bit.
Away from his head?
Yeah, I would say for you, what you should, I mean, and what I'm going to see here and what we're going to do in the trainer is going to be different things, right? But as a stroker, I like his, you don't need all that angle.
Yes.
Reach two hands. Reach like this. You're still going to have a really good reach because you just naturally reach out for it. And what you see here, because of that reach and that top arm bend, you'll see the paddle pivots from the middle. See that? Especially in the beginning. So he's here, now watch this paddle pivot in the middle from the beginning. See that? Here's this.
Yeah.
If you bend the hand back, you give it somewhere to go forward. If it's out there already, can't go anywhere. You won't have that.
Yeah, well that's a great.
Kind of have a little bit of a kick in the back of the stroke, but both one and two have that, right? So you want to think, I mean, everybody's, you can teach whatever you want to teach, but I feel like in the back, you want to be a little bit smoother. If you conserve in the back, you have more for the front, for support. If you pull too hard back here, then you don't have it.
Do you want full pressure all the way through?
Yeah, you do.
And it just sort of naturally lightens up a little bit when the stroke completes?
The faster the boat is going, the easier you can be in the back.
Right. Because of the groove.
Yeah.
Because of the groove.
When you're sprinting, all the way through, there's no room for that. You watch these guys, when they do starts, there's water out in the back. So quarter mile, half mile, right through the stroke.
Yeah.
Boat's running. Conserve. Float.
How do they do their starts?
You know, it's funny.
Do
I, didn't
do
talk,
bidets?
I didn't talk about this.
No.
Deep water, get the boat speed up, grab the water, get to the front quicker, quicker, quicker as the boat speed picks up.
And let me say, too, what we call pinet and what a pinet is
it's not the same.
Is not the same.
Pinet used to be this short.
Yeah.
Everybody's
so
going tap, tap, tap,
we
tap,
call
tap.
It pinet, but
not
we're not
pinet.
Doing a pinet.
Like, it's three strokes. I'd like to think three, four strokes to get the boat up, and then you. Just get to the front quicker, 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 quicker. Try to be in the water. Try to be in the water. Try to be in the water.
Same long stroke.
Yeah.
Don't shorten your stroke length.
No. I mean, I do this. We did this really good drill with Gerard and a deal with the outrigger women last year, where you go, it was about 20 seconds, as fast as you can pull hard and not shorten the stroke.
That's the key. That
we did a running start. I don't do it from dead start. And you go, okay, 20 strokes, full strokes, as fast as you can go. Really, really hard to do because your body just gets taxed. And the Aquatic Center boys with Gerard, you know, they did like this long workout and we did a bunch of them after. And they're hitting like 11 miles an hour, 12 miles an hour. They're just like, it was count. And I think I counted 72. Full strokes, back to the front. And he looks at me and he goes, when you hit 78, you're there. That long, that many strokes a minute, that's when you're at that point. That's what Shell does, right? Anyway, so no, don't. I always say never cheat the stroke. Don't cheat.
And a lot of that, though, comes from learning to relax when you're doing that, because we tighten up
yes.
on the go. We tighten
yeah.
up, shorten up, and hammer.
We had this talk, you know, when you come out of the water, you have to be completely loose. Tension, tension, this, throwing a frisbee, softball, whatever you want to use for the, but the, that's that recovery, right? The fast, it's got to be loose.
Also, when you're loose, you're a lot more power to go through your muscles. If you're tense,
yeah.
you don't have power to go through
usually
your muscles.
Usually, when people tense up here, I feel like when you tense up here, you lose this. It's like once you go here, you lose your power. Comfortable